Jazz Audio presents Journey on a Runaway Train, created by Gertrude Chandler Warner, story by Dee Garretson and J.M. Lee, read for you by Aimee Lilly. Dear reader, okay, it's true. Over the past 75 years, Henry, Jessie, Violet, and Benny Alden have been on a lot of adventures. From their very first trek through the woods in search of shelter to their most recent mysteries, the four siblings known as the Boxcar Children have traveled to scores of new places and found fun at every destination. But beyond the excitement is something more. For all their amazing experiences, the Alden children have always had a deep understanding of family, friendship, and the value of kindness. Which is why the Boxcar Children's greatest adventure yet isn't just about a trip around the world to all seven continents, filled with cool clues and incredible treasures. It's about doing a world of good, returning lost things, expanding horizons, and mending relationships. In a story told in five fast-paced books, the Boxcar Children will go places they've never been before while staying true to who they are. I invite you to come aboard as we celebrate the 75th anniversary of the Boxcar Children and embark on this amazing new journey. My best, Wendy McClure, Editorial Manager at Albert Whitman & Company. Chapter 1. An exciting thing about to happen. The tinkling of little bells woke Jessie Alden up. As she lay in her bed, she wondered whether she had dreamed up the nice noises. She looked over to the window. It was very early in the morning. Her room was just beginning to brighten. The curtains billowed as a breeze blew through them. The bells sounded again. And then Jessie remembered. She and her 10-year-old sister Violet had hung a mobile in Jessie's room the night before. Violet's latest art project was mobile making. For Jessie's mobile, she had cut out pictures of amazing sights from all over the world. The pictures were glued to cardboard and then tied to strings hanging from a wire frame. Violet had added little silver bells on strings to hang among the pictures. She said she hoped her mobile would give Jessie dreams of all the places she might go someday. Jessie listened to the bells, thinking it was almost like they were signaling her to get up. Soft footsteps sounded in the hallway, as if someone was trying not to be heard. Jumping out of bed, Jessie darted over to her door and opened it. Her 14-year-old brother, Henry, and Watch, their dog, were just heading down the stairs. Violet and 6-year-old Benny opened their own doors. Jessie noticed no one looked sleepy.
"Why are we all so awake?" she whispered.
"Well, I was too excited to sleep late, but I don't know why,"
Benny said. "I felt the same way, like something exciting was going to happen and I didn't want to miss it,"
Violet added.
"That's strange," Henry said. "I felt the same way."
Watch wagged his tail as if he was agreeing with them. They stood there for a moment until Violet asked,
"What do we do now? It's really early."
"Well, first, we should go downstairs so we won't wake anyone else up,"
Jessie said. They went down to the kitchen. Henry filled up Watch's bowl with dog food, and Watch wolfed it down.
"I'm just as hungry as Watch,"
Benny said.
"What time is breakfast?"
"Not for a while," Jessie said. "Mrs. McGregor thought we would sleep late since it's the first day of spring break."
Mrs. McGregor was the Aldens' housekeeper.
"Well, how long is a while?"
Benny asked.
"However long it is, I don't think I can wait."
"I have an idea," Violet said. "Since it's finally stopped raining, it would be nice to go outside. Let's make our own breakfast and take it out to the boxcar to eat."
The Aldens had their very own boxcar in their backyard. It was a special place for them. After their parents died, they had been scared to go live at their grandfather's house. Fearing he would be mean, the children had run away and found an old boxcar in the woods. They lived there until their grandfather found them. He wasn't mean at all, and he even arranged for the boxcar to be brought to his yard.
"I like Violet's idea."
Benny jumped up and down.
"We can have a breakfast picnic."
Jessie smiled at Benny's excitement.
"We have some blueberry muffins I made, and there are some bananas. That would be a good breakfast."
"Perfect," Henry said.
"Violet, will you carry the muffins?"
Jessie asked.
I'll take the plates and the bananas. Henry can carry the glasses. Benny, that means you're in charge of the juice.
They took everything out to the boxcar, squishing their way across the wet backyard.
There is something about this morning that feels so different,
Violet said, as they laid out their breakfast. Rain began to ping on the roof of the boxcar.
Except the rain,
Henry sighed.
Well, at least the rain makes the air smell good,
Violet said.
I don't know if I've ever heard so many birds chirping this early in the spring,
Jessie said.
Listen.
It did seem as if their yard was filled with birds. The children were quiet as they ate their breakfast, enjoying the sound of the birds.
Sometimes I wish this boxcar was still attached to a train,
Benny said when they were finished.
And that we were going someplace right now.
I wish we could have an adventure this week,
Jessie said.
We haven't had any mysteries to solve recently, and I'm ready for one. Anyone heard of any mysteries that need solving?
No,
Henry said glumly.
I've even asked around. No one's lost anything or seen any strange things lately.
It's like all the mysteries have been solved,
Violet said, just as glum as Henry.
Oh, don't be sad.
Benny looked around at his brother and sisters.
It's still the first day of spring break. Let's play a game. Everyone, close your eyes and imagine where you'd like the boxcar to go.
There are so many places. It's hard to...
A rumbling noise drowned out the rest of Violet's sentence.
Do you hear that?
Benny opened his eyes.
Is the train moving?
Henry got up and went to the door of the boxcar.
No, it's thunder. Looks like it's going to storm again.
Well, let's get inside before the rain gets too heavy,
Jessie said. They collected the picnic supplies and got ready to run for the back door. Watch jumped out of the boxcar and then stopped, his ears perking up. He gave a bark and then dashed toward the front of the house. As he disappeared around the corner, he began to bark again.
He's going to wake up the neighbors,
Jessie said.
Watch,
Henry called. Watch didn't come back. He kept barking.
Oh, we better go see what he's doing,
Benny said. The four of them ran around the house to the front yard. Violet was in the lead, but when she got to the front yard, she skidded to a stop on the wet grass. The others nearly ran into her.
There's someone on our front porch, she said.
They could see a man standing on the top of the steps, looking at Watch. Watch was on the walkway at the bottom of the steps, looking back at the man. He was an older man, about grandfather's age. He was very small, with a wrinkly face and silvery gray hair that stuck out from underneath a purple cap. When the man saw the Aldens, he tipped his cap at them and smiled. Violet noticed the cap matched the purple bow tie he wore. He had a silver hoop earring in one ear and one front tooth capped in silver.
Good morning, children, he said. Lovely day, isn't it?
Jessie wasn't so sure such a gray, rainy day could be called lovely, but the man didn't even seem to notice he was all wet.
Sorry about our dog,
Henry said to the man.
Watch won't hurt you. He just barks at strangers sometimes.
That's all right, the man replied. I understand. Back when I was a pirate, I learned you can't trust everyone. Sometimes you need to bark at people just to let them know you're watching them.
Benny's eyes opened wide.
You were a pirate?
The man's smile grew.
Some people called me that a long time ago. Today, I'm just passing out flyers. I've put one in your door.
He winked at them and then tipped his cap again.
Good day to you.
He came down the steps and patted Watch on the head as he walked by. The dog wagged his tail. The Aldens watched as the man then strolled down the sidewalk away from them. Right before he turned the corner and disappeared from the Alden sight, he jumped up and clicked his heels together.
Well, that was an interesting man,
Jessie said.
Maybe he was the exciting thing we thought would happen today.
Well, he was interesting, but now he's gone,
Henry said.
Well, that's not very exciting.
I wonder why he left us a flyer.
Violet ran up the steps and pulled out a piece of paper that had been stuck between the door and the frame. She held it up for the others to see. The flyer had an image of an old storage trunk on the top and the words Reddimus Curiosities, Antique Dealers, beneath. Benny pointed to the next line.
I can read the first part. It says...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books,
Use the link in the video description.